Yeah, you should read the chapter if you have the time. If I'm correct, I did a video about this, but somewhere here it mentions that the Israelites were worshiping, well, the people before the flood. Sorry, they were a bunch of nature worshippers. And this is talking about the boat of Noah, so it's not actually talking about, like, you know, worshiping wood, but. If you go on, they was worshiping like in nature, basically. Stocks is a wood. Wood and stone. Stone and wood, it says here. Yeah, so. Right, verse 8, let me see. Judges 3:8. Therefore. So the point is this: we did evil in front of the Lord, and what did the Lord do? Therefore the anger of Yahweh was hot against Israel, and he sold them. He sold them into the hand of Kushan-Rishathaim, king of Mesopotamia. And he sold them. That's what happened to us. And the children of Israel served 8 years. Kushan-Rishathaim. And when the children of Israel cried unto Yahweh, Yahweh raised up and delivered to the children of Israel, who delivered them, even Othniel the son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon him, and he judged Israel, and went out to war. And Yahweh delivered the Cush, king of Mesopotamia, into his hand, and his hand prevailed against Cushan. And the land had rest 40 years, and Othniel, the son of Kenaz, died. Yeah, he was the son of Kenaz. See? But Sorry. Kenaz was the brother of Caleb, sorry. Right. Confusion read. I had something in my head like the Kenazites. I remember I read that, but leave it. And the children, because they was named after their father, the house there. Oh yeah. In the book of Numbers, that's actually Numbers 1. Wait. It says it right here. Let me see. No. That one, it wasn't 1 then. Then it was 2. No. 3 then. I remember that the people were named after the names of their fathers as a household. Wow. Maybe I need to look at my book. Okay. Sorry, because something just jumped in my head and I was like, oh yeah, I remember that. I do remember that again. Let me see. It was Numbers 3. No. Oh, yeah. Jezza. It was Numbers 3. Here. Where is it again? Numbers 3. Right, you had the... Okay, you had the Levites, right? Right. Da-da-da-da-da. Okay, verse 17, Numbers 3 and 17. And these are the sons of Levi by their names, Gershom and Kohath and Merari. These are the names of the sons of Gershom by their families, Libni and Shimei. So by their families, Libni and Shimei, but they were of Gershom, but they were of Levi. And the sons of Kohath by their families, Amram and Izhar, Hebron, which is also a place, Uziel, the sons of Merari by their family, Mahli and Mushi. These are the families of the Levites according to the house of their fathers. So there were Mushiites and Mahilites and Amaramites and stuff like that. And of Gershom was the family of, see, of Gershom come the family of Libnites. And the and the family of the Shemites. These are the families of the Gershonites. See? That's what I was actually looking for in my head. But, well, I was not looking specifically for this, but I was looking for something like this in order to explain, you know, the Canaanites, that, you know, they have all different names and stuff like that, but they're the sons of Ham. Same thing here. They had all different names. For example, they was called the Gershonites, but they was Levites, and they was children of Israel, right? So if they have a little island, you would call them the island of, or the region of the Gershonites, but because they came from Gershon, and so forth. And the chief of the house, verse 23. The families of the Gershonites shall pitch behind the tabernacle westward. And the chief of the house of the father of the Gershonites shall be Eliasaph, the son of Lael. Yeah, so you can read on. Family of Koth, the family. It's here. Verse 27. And of Kohath was the family of the Aramites, which I just read here. See? The Aramites. And you have the Izharites. The Izharites. You have the Aramites here. Hebronites. You have the Hebronites. You have the Uzielites. And you have the, these are the families of the Kohathites. Right. Basically this here. This. And then this. Right. So this is the example that I was looking for without thinking about it. But it jumped in my head. So I was looking for something like this. But yeah. So that's the same thing with here. And also, that's the same thing. You could kind of say it's the same thing with Elijah the Tishbite, but I'm not 100% sure if it was the, just like how they said it, I'm not sure if it was his father or the town, but he did live in Gilead, so he was a Gileadite, but he's an Israelite. You know, I hope it's not confusing for you how I try and explain it. Right. Now this is the book of Judges, chapter 3, verse 12. And the children of Israel did evil again in the sight of Yahweh. And by the way, the reason I read this is to show you that, why do you think we were allowed to go kill them? Yeah, that's why. And why do you think that they were allowed to come and enslave us? Yeah, you got that right. Because we angered the Lord. We did evil in his sight. We started to serve Balaam. And if you read Ezekiel chapter 16, you will see what type of filthy stuff our people were doing. Yeah. I'm going to give you a hint. Because it says it right there in the book of Ezekiel 16. It says that even the people of Sodom and Gomorrah looked at us and said, "Ew! You're nasty." You see that until this day. When you see a Jake sodomite compared to an Edomite sodomite, these Edomites mind it. Well, not all of them, because they're a bunch of crazy devils too. But especially in the 90s and stuff like that, and early 2000s, when they didn't have them heavy diligence on them, right? With they, them, and all that type of crazy he, him, her, she, whatever, right? You often had a nigga vagabond. You often had a nigga ass vagabond. That was just, he was a flaming super being or something like that. Like, "Hey, my nigga, why don't you calm down, bro? Everybody know you're trying to be a girl. So just keep it. Just do your thing and just Don't be so flaming with it, man. Don't be so loud with it, man. You got bright colors on right about now, man. You need to turn it down to a 2. You at about a 22 right now, man. Like, you trying to look like a swan, but a man is not supposed to be beautiful. You know what I'm saying? So, a man is supposed to be handsome. So, turn that thing back down, man. You know what I'm saying? Because they're over-exaggerating. That's what a Jake does. And if you read Ezekiel 16, you gonna agree. You're going to agree. You'll be like, yeah, that's true. They are, like, they just overboard with it, man. Just crazy. Anyway. Judges 3 and 12. And the children of Israel did evil again in the sight of the Lord. And Yahweh strengthened Eglon, the king of Moab, against Israel, because they had done evil in the sight of the Lord. So when you see stuff like this, don't be crying for these people. Fuck them. Because the Lord said, where is it? I had it somewhere. And one day, I will derive thee of children. Where was it again, man? Bereave thee of children in one day. I just had it. Is it Exodus 22? Let me see something. No, that's not it. Yeah, here. Oh, yeah. That's what I'm looking for. Well, I was going to read it anyway, but let me just do it again. Do it before. Isaiah 47 and 9. But these two things shall come to thee in one moment. In a moment, in one day. The loss of children and widowhood. They shall come upon thee in their perfection, for the multitude of thy sorceries, and for the great abundance of thine enchantments. Yeah, here. You see Amalek crying for his little daughter, because that's what I'm crying over. Here you go. Yeah, you better wipe them golden tears, boy. Zoom in with that camera. Get them golden tears on track. Yeah, get them. Right. And I'm going to show you who smoked them. I have it in the description box. I have crazy stuff in the description box that I put there. And then you will see it was no Arab that was doing these things. Who do you think it was? should I read something for you? Check this out. It's called IDF. Oh, yeah. Hannibal. Directive? Wikipedia? Here, Hannibal Directive. Okay, check this out. The Hannibal Directive. Now, you can find this in other places too. The Hannibal Procedure, or Hannibal Protocol, is the controversial procedure, how things happen, you know, procedure, an established or official way of doing something. Yeah, how things happen, right? Procedure used by Israeli Defense Forces, IDF, to do what? So the Hannibal Productor, Hannibal Procedure, or Hannibal Directive, to prevent the capture of Israeli soldiers by enemy forces. That's the Hannibal Directive. In one version, it was the kidnapping. Sorry, it was that the kidnapping must be stopped by all means, even at the price of striking and harming our own forces. I'm not going to read further. I'll put a few links in the description box so you can check it out for yourself. Then you will see who did this, and who did this, and who did... Let me see. Yeah, these are Arabs, but I'm looking for the the Israeli families that were bombed. You know what? I'm not going to talk too much about this. I'm going to put the link in the description box so you can check it out for yourself. But I'll just give you a few hints. You know, I still want to use their platform in order to push our thing. Okay, so yeah, you know, but these are Israeli people. As you can see, this is the Israeli government forces, the police and stuff like that, military. Babies killed in Hamas attack as Israeli death. Okay, check this out. Babies killed in Hamas attack as Israeli death toll passes 1,000. But it's also it was more than 53 UN staff people died also. Why? I'll put the link in the description box. Why? Well, I read it right here for you. That's why. But let me see something. Yeah, here. Hey, here you go. I just read it for you. Hamas says 60 hostages killed in Israeli airstrike on Gaza. Should I read it again? In one version, it was that the kidnapping must be stopped by all means, even at the price of striking or harming our own forces. And these are about military. If they don't give a shit about their military, would they give a shit about their hostages? But anyway, I'll leave this link in the description box so you can check it out for yourself. Right, going back to over here. By the way, these are people that got smoked by friendly fire. I'll put this link in the description box too. But they're not going to tell you that. I'll tell you that. Through other Edomites that are snitching on themselves. That's the fun part. They make it their own tongue to fall upon themselves. Ain't it dope when you see them turning on upon each other? Just like in the book of Judith, you had our people also turning upon each other too. In the book of 1 Maccabees, Jason was the turning upon us too. You know, snitches. You know, so yeah. 1 Maccabees chapter 1 also shows you that our people turned against each other. Because they wanted to serve the Greeks. Not the Romans, the Greeks. And they served the Romans too, to benefit their own. Look in the book of Acts, where it says that Romans shall come. Here. Oh, it was John. Oops. What's the next? John 11:48. If we let him, Yahushai, thus alone, all men will believe on him, all his miracles, because he rose somebody up from the dead. I think it was Lazarus. In this chapter, it was Lazarus, I think. Let me see something. Yeah, it was Lazarus. He woke up Lazarus. And then, 1 John 11:14, then said Jehoshaphat unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead. And then later on, let me see, he woke him up. Their brother shall rise. No. Yeah, he woke him up here. He woke him up, huh? I clicked on it and it went here. What? Why doesn't it come here? Oh, it was the 6th. Okay, because I was like, hey, what? Okay, right. Anyway, yeah. So he woke him up out of the dead. And then they said, if we let him thus alone, all men will believe on him, and the Romans shall come and take away both our place, the rank, the status that they had, and nation, and the power that they have over their own nation. Because the Romans told them, like, listen, just do the things that I tell you to do, and I'm going to put you as the head over them, okay? That's the same thing that Esau's doing right now. With suckers like this, the WEF. You got another mother like this. You got another mother like Ethiopians. This, you got another mother like this. This is not our people, but he is still put over his own people. And the war, boy, the war crimes you don't want to know what these people are doing in the country that they have been put over, like females like this. It's the same thing here. Yeah. When you see them dye their hair brown, you already know what the hell is going on, because their hair is black naturally. This is their natural hair, because they Ethiopians. They have this hair naturally. You know, so when you see them strain their hair and dye their hair, you already know. Like, you should know. I'll tell you that. We live amongst these beasts, so you should know. But if they don't do that, they're very feminine. Very feminine. They're very listenative. They listen to you. If you was to be in a relationship with them, they'll cook, they'll clean. But as soon as they are westernized like this, they're worse than a white woman. I'll tell you that. They're worse than an Edomite. I'll tell you, because they get that taste of power. Tastes good. Got cave monkeys like this gassing them up. So yeah, but anyway, they're very cruel against their people. I'll tell you that. Right, so heathen nations do it. Esau is putting our people up to do it also. So they've been doing this, man. Since over 2,000 years ago, they was always doing this. Yeah. But right. So the point of me grabbing this is to show you that these people have done wicked in the eyes of the Lord, and therefore they were allowed to get their ass smoked and bombed. So that's why you shouldn't give a fuck about them. That's my point of showing that. Because our people got put into slavery, we got killed because we did evil in the sight of the Lord. Well, now it's their turn. Bye-bye. Going on. Don't. If you see the shit that these Arabs are doing toward our people right about now, man, you would wish more of them would be fucking buried, man. You don't know, you know? But then again, yeah. Hopefully now you get a little bit of insight, or you know, you hear about the things that these Arabs are doing toward us. Yeah, so a lot of people, when they go to the Arabian countries, they get snatched up and then they get sold into slavery. Yes, in 2023, we living in 2023, right? You got daughters, you got sons snatched up and sold. And the Arabs been known for selling it's like slave owners. Like, look at what they did to Joseph. That was before we were even a nation. There was already slave drivers. So let that sink in. These people need to get what they did, what they get. Let's say that Yahawashi said, every man shall get according to his deeds. What you have done in your flesh, that's what you're gonna get. Just like how we got punished, the Lord set up Eglon to come and fight against us. Going on. Judges 3:13. And he gathered unto him the children of Ammon and Amalek. So Moab came with Ammon and Amalek. It was just Esau. Japan. China. And smote Israel. They killed us. And possessed the cities of palm trees. So they took our lands. So the children of Israel served Eglon, the king of Moab, 18 years. 18 years we were slaves unto these people. But when the children of Israel cried unto Yahweh, Yahweh raised them up a deliverer, Ehud, the son of Gera, a Benjamite. So he was a Gerarite, but he was a Benjamite by, you know, 12 tribes lineage. A left-handed man. And by him, the children of Israel sent a present unto Eglon, the king of Moab. And then guess what the Lord did to the king of Moab? He killed him. But he did use Eglon to come and kill us, because our people sinned. And then when we stopped sinning, we prayed to the Lord. Then the Heavenly Father set up Ehud. And what did Ehud do? He killed him. And you can read the rest for yourself if you have the time. You know, it's very exciting. This is our history, right? Also, concerning our history, Exodus chapter 12, this is why we have the Passover, to celebrate their deaths. So when they have their black peat, and when they have their Native American thing, what's it? Thanksgiving, they celebrate our deaths and our victories, that they took us over, enslaved us, and stuff like that. Rape, rob, murdered us. They're celebrating. It's good. Let them have their feast. Now it says it. Exodus chapter 12, verse 26. And this shall come, and it shall come to pass, when your children shall say unto you, what mean ye by this service, the service of keeping the Passover? That ye shall say, it is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, who passed over the houses of the children of Israel, passed over, when he smote the Egyptians and delivered our houses. That's the reason we keep this custom, this service that we do. And the people bowed the head and worshipped. So, why do we keep the Passover? What is the meaning of this service? What is the meaning of keeping the Passover? To celebrate their deaths, and to celebrate the deliverance of our people, and to celebrate the fact that we were no more slaves of them. That's what we do when we do this. So, they do it too, but they do it in unrighteousness. That's what the Lord saith. Once that time comes, we shall see. We shall see, man. We shall see if you are still bold. Let me see. We should not dwell in the land. Right. So the Lord used hornets to go and kill them. Different things, you know. Right. So, Deuteronomy chapter. Wait, then we have a few more precepts. 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 23. And what one. Wait, no. Let me go on. Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6. For thou art an holy people unto Yahweh thy power. Yahweh thy power hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself, above all people that are upon the face of the earth. Yahweh did not set his love upon you, nor chose you, because ye were more in number than any people. For ye were the fewest of all people. We was only 37 people. Exodus chapter 1, verse. Well, in the beginning we was 37, but then we were 70. Exodus chapter 1, verse 5. And all the souls that came out of the loins of Jacob were 70 souls. For Joseph was in Egypt already. So, it was 72, if I'm correct. But, when we went over there, it was 36, if I'm correct. Let me see. Or 60. Or was it 66? It was 66, yeah, it was 66. It's Genesis 38. Yeah, here also. Genesis 46 and 26. All the souls that came with Jacob into Egypt, which came out of his loins, beside Jacob's sons' wives, all the souls were, oh, that's why I said three. 66, which is 60 is 20. Here, a group or set of 20, or about 20. In this case, it's 100% 20. So this is 63 times 20, and then 6. 66. And then later on, the other ones came, which would then therefore be 72. But I do remember that it was somewhere it said 36, actually. Let me see something. Or maybe it was that what I just saw then. 7, no, 9. Oh yeah, see, oh yeah, these were moved and does not include Joseph or his two sons. Yeah, which would then be 3 extra. Which would then be, let me see, 3 extra, right? Oh, I remember why I said 36. It was here. This was the 36, if I'm correct. Oh, here, yeah, sorry. Right. Okay, so it was oh shit. Come on. Right, so it was 70 souls, for Joseph was in Egypt already, and Joseph had 2 sons, which is 73. Yeah, 73. I said 72. I was thinking of those two. Only, except Joseph, sorry. So 73. So we as a nation were only 73 deep. Right. And the children of Israel were fruitful and increased abundantly and multiplied and waxed exceeding mighty. And the land was filled with them. Exodus chapter 1 verse 7 I just read. Right. So we were the fewest of all people in existence. Isaiah chapter 47 verse... Wait. 2 Samuel chapter 7 verse 23. And what one nation in the earth is like thy people? Even like Israel. No one. Sorry. No one whom Yahweh want to redeem for a people to himself and to make him a name. And to do for you great things and terrible. For thy land before thy people, which thou redeemest to thee from Egypt. Which we came from Egypt. And what is the redeemed? Remember saying for the false, yeah? Gain or regain possession of. And he did regain possession of us. Because he told Moses to go tell Pharaoh. Exodus 4 and 22. And thou shalt say unto Pharaoh, thus saith the Yahweh, Israel is my son, even my firstborn. And I say unto thee, let my son go, that he may serve me. And if thou refuse to let him go, behold, I will slay thy son, even thy firstborn. And a lot of people are also have noticed that a lot of people have a problem, so-called Christians, again, fucking devils, have a problem with the Lord killing the firstborn of the sons of death. This is why the scripture is 100% the truth, man. They have a problem with the Heavenly Father killing the firstborn of the Egyptians and even the firstborn of the animals. Because remember that, remember this? Exodus chapter 1 verse 15. And the king of Egypt spake to the Hebrew midwives, of which the name of the one was Sheva, and the name of the other was Puah. And he said, when ye do the office of a midwife to the Hebrew women, and see them upon the stools, this, you had the Egyptians were doing this. They were sitting down on a chair like this. This is a birth stool. This is a stool. This is how you give birth. Actually, you're supposed to sit up and not lie down. You know, Esau used to do it too back in the days, as you can clearly see it here. But I think this is new. This is bullshit. This is real. This is ancient. This is old. This is some new crap. Anyway, when ye do the office of a midwife, those two females are midwives, by the way. These two on the side over here. These two on the sides are midwives. So we didn't go to no damn hospitals, pay money and shit for a child to be born up in this world. We did it ourselves. We had women that was trained and guided to do these things. Another man is not supposed to see your wife's punane. And the whole gang up in that delivery room neither. And he said, what? Exodus chapter 1 and 16. And he said, the king Pharaoh said, when ye do the office of a midwife to the Hebrew women and see them upon the stools, if it be a son, then ye shall kill him. But if it be a daughter, then she shall live. But the fact that he wanted to kill them shows you. But the midwives feared Yahweh and did not as the king of Egypt commanded them, but saved the men children alive. Wanted to kill them. And the king of Egypt called for the midwives and said unto them, why have ye done this? And have saved the men children alive. Well, you can read the rest for yourself if you want to. Here, this is what he did. Verse 21. And it came to pass, because the midwives feared Jehovah, that he made them houses. And Pharaoh charged all his people, saying, every son that is born ye shall cast into the river, and every daughter ye shall save alive. Why? Because you can. They're not a threat. You can fuck them. They're not a threat. So he killed them. So people that have a problem with, you know, that the Heavenly Father killed their firstborn, I'm looking at you like, you probably don't know. And you don't care. That's the point. Jeremiah, and you don't think. Jeremiah chapter 15, verse 5. For who shall have pity upon thee, O Jerusalem? Or who shall bemoan thee? Or who shall go aside to ask how thou doest? They don't give a shit how you doing. So, nigger, how you feel today? Well, I'm kind of shut the fuck up, nigger. This is not fucking, okay? It's not COINTEL, okay? You sit back, you know what I'm saying? It's just like saying, how you doing today? It's just a figure of speech, nigger. Sit fuck back in the goddamn, back of the bus, nigger, back of the bus. Deuteronomy chapter 9, verse 10. Wait. 12. Daniel 9 and 12. And he had confirmed his words, which he spake against us. The Lord confirmed his words. And against our judges that judged us, by bringing upon us a great evil, slavery, and destruction, of course. For under the whole heaven had not been done, as had been done upon Jerusalem. So these people don't pity you. They don't have nothing for you. You know why? If they pity us, you know why that would be? Psalms 106, verse 40. Therefore was the wrath of Yahweh kindled against his people, insomuch that he abhorred his own inheritance. Why? Because we were sacrificing our sons and daughters to devils, as it says here. You can read the rest of the chapter if you have the time for yourself. And he gave them into the hand of the heathen, and they that hated them ruled over them. For a jump to verse 46. Verse 45. And he remembered for them his covenant, and repented according to the multitude of his mercies. And by the way, he brought us low. He had made them also to be pitied of all those that carried them captives. So everybody that had us in slavery, eventually they pitied us. But we angered the Lord so much that this is what he did concerning making the enemies pity us. Hosea chapter 1 verse 6. And she conceived again and bare a daughter. And Yahweh said unto him, call her name Lo. Pardon. Lo Ruhamah, for I will no more have mercy upon the house of Israel, but I will utterly take them away. Verse 9. Then said Yahweh, call his name Lo Ami, for ye are not my people, and I will not be your power. Yet we will be called the sons of the Most High. But the point is that he took away that mercy from us, from the heathen nations. Nobody pities us now. They don't. Because the Lord put that spirit on them, because our people are superiorly stubborn. And therefore we are not pitied. But he that pleaseth the Lord, he will make even his enemies be at peace with him. So among the Israelites, you have Israelites that be like, you're looking at them like, eh? Huh? No, nothing happens to them. they don't rough him up. The police ain't roughing him up. They're very friendly with this guy. Well, that's maybe because he pleases the Lord. You know? So, yeah, there you have it. Right, so going on back over here. 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 23. And what one nation in the earth is like unto thy people, even like Israel, whom Yahweh want to redeem for a people to himself, and to make him a name, and to do for you great things and terrible for thy land before thy people, which thou redeemest thee from Egypt, from the nations and their gods. For thou hast confirmed to thyself thy people Israel to be a people unto thee forever. And thou, Yahweh, art become their power. And now, O Yahweh, the power, the word that thou hast spoken concerning thy servant and concerning his house, establish it forever, and do as thou hast said. The Lord is not a man that he should lie. If he says, he will do it. And let thy name be magnified forever, saying, Yahweh, the Lord of hosts, is the power over Israel. And let the house of thy servant David be established before thee, as thou hast said. And then therefore get his son to be in his place, as thou hast also said, that son of David, King Solomon. Exodus 19 and 5. Now therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed, and keep my covenant, then ye shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people. For all the earth is mine. So, this shows you that we're not equal. But don't worry. Once that time gets... You see, if you watch that documentary, You Are Amalek, you will damn sure know that these Amalekites believe that they're better than you. You are cattle, goyim, you're spit. They're allowed to kill your kids. Everything and anything in existence, they're allowed to do to you. They're allowed to do anything to you. Poison your food because you're nothing. They're better than you. They believe that. They truly believe that. They even believe it so much that they so-called don't... Wait, let me say it better. That they don't deal with so-called terrorists. They don't make deals with you. They'll bomb the shit out you. They don't give a... 1 Peter 2 and 9. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. I was thinking of something, right? Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Because I just read this and I was like, wait a minute. I skipped over something. Exodus chapter 19, verse 6. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and an holy nation. These are the words where thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel, which is the sons of Israel, by the way. Because a woman is not a priest. Never can, never will be accepted in the eyes of Yahweh Bashem Yahshai. Esau, well, Klaus Schwab, he's your God. 1 Peter 2 and 9. Well, he's one of your gods. He's one of your Roman gods. He actually looked like a filthy Roman if you look like him, like if you look at him like that, you know. 1 Peter 2 and 9. But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who had called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. That's why we praise Yahweh Bashem Yahshai. The fact that we're talking to you right now. That's beauty in itself. Deuteronomy 14 and 2. For thou art an holy people unto Yahweh thy power, and Yahweh had chosen thee to be a peculiar people unto himself above all nations that are upon the face of that are upon the earth. Yeah, I was coloring, so I didn't look when I was reading on, sorry. Above all nations that are upon the earth. Deuteronomy 28 and 9. Yahweh shall establish thee and holy people unto himself, as he had sworn unto thee, if thou shalt keep the commandments of Yahweh thy power and walk in his ways, which we didn't do. That's why we are where we are right now. But ain't that the fun part? I mean, when you watch a movie, right? Do you want the ending to be in the beginning of the movie? No. You want all these beautiful things to go through, right? You go through some things. And then at the end of the movie, when he kills the bad guy, he gives a standing ovation, man. God, kill that motherfucker, man. He did that shit to you. He got his kids back. He killed everybody in his fucking family. That's our life. We're the good guy that have been messed with above what they was allowed to do. Because the Lord said, I am so displeased Zechariah 1 and 15. I am very sore displeased with the heathen that are at ease. Yeah, you are at ease. Like nothing is going to happen to you. For I was but a little displeased with the Israelites and punished them. Right? And they held further the affliction. So they was bold with it. They was like, we got it from here, Lord. Just leave it up to us. Okay? Right? Therefore, so because you did this, therefore, thus saith Yahweh, I am returned to Jerusalem with mercies, the multitude of his mercies. My house shall be built in it, saith Yahweh, Lord of hosts. And the line shall be stretched forth upon Jerusalem. Let me see. Yeah, cast out the horn of the Gentiles. This is their power. The Lord will. Let me jump to it. Verse 21. Zechariah 1 and 21. Then said I, what come these to do? And he spake, saying, these are the horns which have scattered Judah. Yeah, these are the powers which have scattered us. So that no man did lift up his head. We wasn't proud anymore. But these are come to fray them, to cast out the horns of the Gentiles. Let's pray again. It that puts men in fear, the boil, quarrel, or violent riot that puts men in fear, fight against them, basically. To cast out the horns of the Gentiles, which lifted up their horn over the land of Judah to scatter it. And that horn represents their power that they have. Because a ram or a ox, yeah, without horns, he's not really that dangerous. You know, he's not really that tough. But he's not really that tough, you know, but he can do things to you, man, because he got them horns. So this represents power. This is Photoshop. This is real also. And this one, yeah, this thing. Yeah, he's not that tough without his horns. But with his horns, why don't you give him a headbutt? see what happens to you. This represents power, bro. You know what I'm saying? But there's a few scriptures that actually goes into showing you that is... Wait, Right, for example, of the horn being power. Also, oh yeah. Deuteronomy 33 and 17. His glory is like the firstling of his bullock, and his horns like the horns of unicorns, which are. Rhinos, that's what I'm looking for. Rhinos, unicornus. Rhinoceros unicornus is a unicorn. This is a unicorn. It's a very powerful beast, and you cannot tame him. You can try if you want to. Die. You can try if you want to. This is not a pet. You might have them in zoos and stuff like that. You see the guys playing around with them. Why don't you go hang around that guy? It's not like a dog that, you know, you can train him to not be to be a guard dog, but not be a, you know, aggressive dog and stuff like that. You can train a dog, but you can't train him. He's unpredictable. You do something stupid, you might end up around here. Or this might end up round in you. So with the unicorns, with the horns of the unicorn, with them he shall push the people together to the ends of the earth. See? With the horns, which represents power. And they are the 10,000s of Ephraim, and they are the thousands of Manasseh. Ephraim had a lot of babies. Right, Deuteronomy 25 and 4. Thou shalt not muzzle the ox that treadeth out the corn. They step on it. Corn thread. Here, this is what you did with the ox. You step on this thing, and then the ox would carry you, and then you would grind the weed. You would grind the weed. You would grind it. Tread it out the corn. And they also used to use horns. They also used to use the corn, I mean the ox, his horn, in order to flatten the weed. Wait, let me. Like a great millstone, like this. Weed. Then you would put the weed in there. You would put this weed here, and then you would grind it and flatten it and make meal, and then you would be able to make bread. Right. So that's the flat that's the flattening of the hoofs, for example. This is the horn. These are the hoofs. Step on it. 1 Kings 22 and 11. And Zedekiah the son of Hanana made him horns of iron, and they said, thus saith Yahweh, with these shalt thou push the Syrians until thou have consumed them. So it represents power again. Micah 4 and 3, 13. Arise and thresh, O daughter of Zion, for I will make thy horn iron, and I will make thy hooves brass, so we can step on them and flatten them. And thou shalt beat in pieces many people with horns of iron and hoofs of brass. And I will consecrate their gain unto Yahweh, and their substance unto the Lord of the whole earth. Micah 148 and 14. He also exalted the horn of his people, the praise of all his saints, even of the children of Israel, a people near unto him, near unto the Lord. Praise ye Yahweh. Right. So yeah. So these heathens, they have their horns too. They have their power too. especially if we serve other gods. Then their gods will be mightier than ours. And then we die. Get destroyed. But these people don't care about us. Therefore, when you see stuff like this happening to them, don't be all bucked up out of shape. Just know that they did something to where they deserve what they get. Am I going to point out laughing at them? Not necessarily. You thought I would say, oh, no, no, no. I'll laugh when I feel like it. But don't think that they're going to escape. Don't think that they're going to escape like nothing is going to happen to them. Look at what they're doing over here. You don't think that the Lord is going to snap on them too? The Lord is snapping on them first. Yeah. And after that, he's going to be snapping on them. That's going to be a funny part. You know? Funny. But yeah. So, then you have here the book of Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 4. No, chapter 7. Wait a minute. Right, no, sorry about that. No, I was looking up something. But anyway, so it's 1 Esdras chapter 8, as you can see here. Verse 82. And now, O Yahweh, what shall we say, having these things? For we have transgressed thy commandments, which thou gavest by the hand of thy servants the prophets, saying, that the land which ye enter into possess as an heritage is a land polluted with the pollutions of the strangers of the land. Ezekiel 17. And they have filled it with their uncleanness. The book of Leviticus 18, the book of Leviticus 20, but more actually 18. Therefore, now shall ye not join your daughters unto their sons, neither shall ye take their daughters unto your sons. Moreover, ye shall never seek to have peace with them, that ye may be strong, and eat the good things of the land, and that ye may leave the inheritance of the land unto your children forevermore. That's why you see the Arabs is always sticking together, making children with each other. That's why you see the Turkish people do the same thing. That's why you see people of India do the same thing. That's why you see all these other heathen nations do the same thing. But us, they push in the commercials to have Edomite wives and children with Edomite males as Jake females. That's why they push this in the commercials heavily upon us. You don't see an Arab made a Hindi with an East Indian in commercials. You don't see a Japanese with a dark brown person from Thailand. You don't see that in the commercial. You don't see that. You don't see that, man. You see Jake and Esau. That's what you see. Amalek wants to break Esau, but he damn sure has been breaking you. You Jakes. You don't see that, man. And for anyone here in the Netherlands, what's the first and the last time you've seen a Native American from South America? Not the Native Americans from North America. I mean, from South America in the commercials here in the Netherlands, or a billboard on the street when you pass by a bus station, station, or metro station, or train station. What's the last time you saw one that you can recognize, like, oh, yeah, hey, that's a native? What's the last? I'm not talking about them begging posters and stuff like that, where they want you to send money for some poor kids in Africa, or some poor kids in India, or some poor kids in South America. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about in a good light. Like, you know, successful, whatever. Successful in this world, which is bullshit anyway. But the point is that they're not doing it. That's the point. Only when they want to make mockery of you. Like, look at these poor people. That's when they do it. And even then, they don't even do it. Let me ask you that question. When's the last time you saw a Native American from South America an ad talking about gonna help them. You don't see even that. You know? So come on, man. You think these people like you, man? They hate you, man. They push bullshit upon us and our people are gobbling it up. Especially in the commercial.